بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا وطيبا مباركا فيه وأصلي وأسلم على نبينا الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وعلى من تمسك بسنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ثم أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. As you heard, today's lecture has been entitled by the brothers who came up with the lecture, Who Are the Saved Sect? Who are the Saved Sect? Presenting this quick lecture, inshallah azza wa jal, the emphasis of this lecture is not upon a name, any name, even if that name happens to be found in the Quran or found coming authentically from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's important if it's in the Quran. It's important if you found the name in the Sunnah. So I'm not saying it's not important, but the emphasis is not upon the name, but the emphasis is more upon the essence and the reality of the name and the description. So I don't want the presentation to be a strictly theological presentation or theoretical presentation. I don't want it to be like that. This is an important issue when we talk about who are the saved sect. It's important because we have a religious obligation to struggle and to strive to be from that saved sect. It's part of our religion. It's from the aqidah of the Muslim to try to come to know, to embrace this particular issue, this idea, because the Prophet spent many, many words, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and a lot of concern and emphasizing this particular issue. So it's important. So if we were to talk about al-husnul khuluq, good akhlaq, and things like that, and we brought all of the ahadith and all of the ayat about the good character, but it's just verbiage and it's just rhetoric and it's just theory. The dhikr of those ahadith is good that we make the dhikr, but the big goal and the big objective is to inculcate that, to practice it, to be upon it. So this lecture today is an important lecture. Again, but I'm not emphasizing here some of these names that we're going to hear that we've heard before. When we talk about the saved sect, the saved sect in Arabic is al-firqatu najiyah, al-firqa al-najiyah. It's part of the Arabic vocabulary that the Muslim should know. The Muslim, he should have some kind of background. Certain words are in our religion that we should know about. Other words, we're not going to blame people if they didn't hear that word. If someone were to ask a normal, regular Muslim, what do you understand when the word is used, al-masalih al-mursala? Al-masalih al-mursala. He never studied Arabic language. He's an ajam, a non-Arab. So if you ask him that word, and he says, I don't know. He doesn't know how to break it down, try to listen to some haruf in the word that he can possibly make an attempt to explain and to translate. We're not going to blame him for that because you don't hear that very often. Unless you're a serious student and you're dealing with jurisprudence and you're dealing with fiqh, when you hear that word, al-masalih al-mursala, you're not going to understand that. The Arab who knows Arabic language, if he's not a student of knowledge, and you ask him that word, what is it? He won't be able to tell you what it is unless he was exposed to knowledge. And it's not even really a complicated word. It's not one of the most difficult words or phrases you're going to come by. But there are certain words that should not escape the mind and the ears of the Muslim, especially during this time. The time of trials and tribulations. This is a time of fitna. The time where the sunnah has been looked at as being something to be opposed. And innovation is being looked at as something to be upon. And if something were to be abandoned or taken away from the people that is from innovation, the people are going to say the sunnah has been taken. I gave a khutbah last week in a masjid. Beautiful masjid, big masjid, built from the ground up. Really nice masjid. And I went there and I was rushing. When I got there, I made it just in time. I went to the minbar. I went to get up on the minbar and they stopped me and they said, you have to say assalamu alaikum, and then the mu'adhin is going to make the adhan, and then everybody's going to do their sunnahs, and then you say assalamu alaikum again, and then you make the second adhan. So I didn't want to fight them at that time, but I showed them my displeasure. I showed them my displeasure, but right that moment wasn't the time to fight them and to educate them, and then we're going to have drama in front of the people. So I did what they wanted me to do. When it was time to give the khutbah, 20 minutes had passed already. It was 10 minutes left for the khutbah. That adhan right there, doing the khutbah, I mentioned it. That adhan right there is not the correct time or the correct way to make the adhan, even if they do it in Mecca or Medina. It's not the correct way. So if you convince the administration of that masjid, take this adhan out, the people are going to say the sunnah has been taken out. This is the time that we're living in right now. The sunnah has become innovation. The innovation has become sunnah. Tawheed has become shirk, and shirk has become tawheed. The truthful person is not trusted, and the untrustworthy person is the one who the people will trust. So everything is topsy-turvy. So this issue, the saved sect, comes from the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which he said the famous hadith that my ummah is going to divide and break up into 73 different types of sects. And he called all 73 of them firqa. All of them are sects. He said they all will be rejected. All of them will be in the hellfire except one. The companion said, which one is that? Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said, "Alladhi ala mithli ma ana alayhi al-yawm wa ashabi." The group, the sect, that are doing the same thing that I'm doing today, and they're doing what my companions are doing today. They're the ones who are going to be saved, this particular group. Another narration from this same hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the companion said, who are those who are going to be saved, Ya Rasulullah? He said, hiya al-jama'a. It is the group, al-jama'a. Meaning, the jama'a of people who are doing what the companions were doing and what the Prophet was doing, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the point here is, the saved sect, this concept comes from the word and from the mouth and the mishkat of al-nabuwa, from the well of prophecy, the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wasallam. 2 points that we want to make before we move on, inshallah, concerning where this word came from, and 2 important points about the word. Point number one is that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when this ummah breaks up into 73 sects, all of them will be in the hellfire except one. So that goes to show us, any group of Muslims, no matter what they are claiming and no matter what their slogan is saying and no matter what they are aspiring to be as it relates to their group, if it is not what the companions were upon, then it is rejected, no matter who it is. I gave a talk a few weeks ago about innovation. And we told you that the hadith said all innovations are dalala. They are going astray. And all forms of going astray lead into the hellfire. So there's no innovation that is hasana. There is no innovation that is wajiba. There is no innovation, bid'ah, that is mustahabba or makruha. All innovations are dalala. All of them, without any exception, without any istithna, zero. Innovations in the religion, not outside of the religion. So similar to that, It's not acceptable for people to come and say like there are innovations that are makruha, innovations that are highly recommended, and innovations that are disliked, like those five issues that we have in the fiqh of Islam. Similar to that is this hadith. The language of the Nabi is clear. The language of the Arabs is clear. Rasulullah said in the hadith, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, all of those groups will be in the hellfire. All of them, except one. Which one is that? Here is the exception of the rule. He said, the one that's doing what I'm doing today and my companions, the jama'ah that is upon what they were doing. So that goes to show it's not permissible for people to enter into the same sect, any sect that they're doing things and saying things fundamentally that the companions weren't upon. So these groups that we have today, without any exception, I don't make any exception, any group you can think of, any group that you can think of, Sufi group, political group, any group, and there are many groups, the people who curse the companions from the people of Tashayyur, Ikhwan al-Muslimin, Jamaat Tabligh, all of the Sufi group, any and every group that the Muslims have created for themselves, when you look at that group and you start to see what they say and what they believe and what their ethos is, what their minhaj is, we're going to say, nope, the companions did not call to wholesale takfir. The companions of the Prophet ﷺ did not put their intellect before the text. The companions of the Prophet ﷺ did not do things where they disregarded considering the harms and the benefits. Whatever the group is doing, the companions were not a group of people who engaged in innovation as their way. Whether it was the dhikr that the people are doing. People turn the lights off, they come together, they make the dhikr. We say, I don't care what you call yourself. Shazari, Tijani, whatever you call yourself. This thing that you're upon, the companions were upon. So therefore, since they were not upon it, that thing, the Ikhwan Muslimin, every group is in the hellfire. Now pay attention to this. Every group, Al-Jamaat al-Islami, Jamaat al-Tabligh, any group you can think of is rejected. Shabab, Qaeda, Boko Haram, all of it is in the hellfire. Because clearly anybody who has eyes, ears, and an intellect, he could come and he can compare what the companions were doing and what these other people were doing. But when I say that all of those groups are rejected in the hellfire, Shabab, all of them, I'm not saying that every individual in that group will be in the hellfire. I'm not saying that. So don't get that twisted. I'm not saying that every single individual in that group is in the hellfire. Just as the Nabi of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made it clear that certain sins and certain mistakes that Muslims make, the one who does it will be in the hellfire. When we see someone doing a mistake, like not wearing hijab correctly, for an example, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are going to come a group of women. And these women are going to wear their jilbabs and their hijabs in a way in which it will look like camel humps on their heads. He said, they're from the people of the hellfire and I have not seen them because that was not present during the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we look at a lady and we see her hijab is like that. You cannot say, you sister are in the hellfire because you fit this description. You can't say that. As long as the human being is living, you say the description is this and that. But what you die upon, Allah knows best. And even if you were to die upon what you're doing, the ruling and the judgment is ultimately with Allah. But I want to repeat, because as it relates to this issue of 73 sects, we have the people who want to accommodate everybody today. Du'at, who graduated from Medina. Shuyukh, people who are Arabs, who are supposed to know. Come in playing around with this issue. All of the groups in al-Islam, the way we have it, groups that lead to hizbiya, groups that lead to at-tafarruq and ikhtilaf. I don't like you and you don't like me because I'm Jamaat al-Tabligh and you Hizb al-Tahrir and he's this and he's that. All of that Islam is against it. It's haram, you young people, trying to be a Muslim. And you go and connect yourself to some group to try to find your identity. Don't connect yourself to any group. Connect yourself to the general Muslims, and from the general Muslims, try to be a person who your religion is the Quran and the Sunnah, and what the Prophet brought, taught, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how the companions embraced that. As for every other group, abandon it. And when I say group, I'm not talking about our shabab, our youngsters who go to the University of Birmingham, so they have an ISOC. ISOC is a group. We're not talking about that. That's an organization that people come together in order to get money for orphans. That's an organization that people come together in order to do some birr. That's an organization that people come together in order to do something that's from our religion. We're not talking about that. That's permissible and that's okay, provided you're not in that organization and you love and you hate based upon that organization. You're just with that organization because it serves the function of doing something Islamic. Nothing wrong with that. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the Jama'at. And I hope there's someone in the audience who will be a man and don't just sit there and listen to what I'm saying, but after this lecture, let's have a discussion if you think that it's permissible to be from any of these groups. All of the groups that the Muslims have created for themselves is an innovation and it's haram. And that's why we don't find that during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. We don't find a group of his companions setting themselves aside as the jihadiyun. We don't find another group of the companions setting themselves and breaking off, and they have a special sha'ira. They are the people of a zuhud. And then another group, they're the students and the people of knowledge. And then another, we don't have that. A group, Ahlul Bayt, and they have some special way of existing. They didn't have that. We have the Ansar and we have the Muhajireen. And they were called that religiously. And whenever that difference between them led to an ikhtilaf and a tafarruq, differences and splitting up, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam set them straight so that nothing was left for people now to be in ambiguity. There was some ikhtilaf, some tafarruq that almost happened between some of the tribes, between the Ansar and the Muhajireen. But the Quran came down and set it straight with ayat. The Sunnah came down and set it straight. So nobody can come and now say, but there were the Ansar and the Muhajireen. Allah Azza wa Jal allowed that. And in the hadith, all of them will be in the hellfire except what I'm doing. So the Ansar and the Muhajireen have the stamp of the approval of the Nabi of Al-Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. So again, all of these groups are not permissible. The second issue, ikhwani, about this Furqat al-Najiyah is that the Furqat al-Najiyah is a synonym for other descriptions that have either come to us from the Quran or the Sunnah or the ijtihad of the ulama of al-Islam. And they all mean the same. We found, because we're living in the time of fitna, things are topsy-turvy. And that's why I say, ikhwani, we need to relax in giving dawah to our community. Reverts, people born in Europe, born and raised in Pakistan with a religion of al-Islam, with the awam, the ammatanas in Pakistan, don't know what they're doing. The ammatanas in Africa don't know what they're doing. Especially West Africa, South Africa, the Arabs, the Africans who have some Arab in them, like Sudanese, like Egyptians, you know, those kinds, Somalis, those Arabs from Algeria, Morocco, those Arabs tend to have more, those Africans tend to have more knowledge than the pure Africans, generally speaking. We're living in a time right now when Arabs from this ummah don't even know what they're doing. When you read the stuff, it blows you away. For an example, during the time of fitna right now, every group is happy with what it has. So these issues of the religion are mixed up and confused. So we have these people who are writing and they're saying the Firqat al-Najiyah is one group, and then Ahlul Hadith are another group, and then a third group
is a Salafia, for an example. And they bring proofs to try to show that they're different things. This is the time we're living in right now. This is the time that we're living in right now. So as it relates to this word that the Prophet used, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the safe sect, this is not a theory. Everybody has to struggle to be from the safe sect. What is the safe sect? It is trying to be a Muslim where you're trying to do everything that you do, what you believe, your worship, your aqidah. You put yourself in a position to imitate and to emulate those companions. Simple as that. Nothing more, nothing less. Nothing more, less, nothing less. So when the Nabi said that to the companions, and they, radiallahu anhum, wanted more elaboration, who are they, ya Rasulullah? That is the religion. Those companions wanting to know who this saved sect are. Who are they? You need to know. And then he explained, they're you people. The ones who are doing what I'm doing today and what you're doing, my companions. So now as Muslims, we don't have a choice except to struggle and to strive to be on that sect, to be with that group. And sectarianism, being in a sect, there's nothing wrong with being in a sect. But you have to be with the sect of the companions, the Hizb of Allah, the fiqh that the companions were upon. So being on that sect and with that group, nothing's wrong with that. But being with any other sect, especially the ones that are in opposition to that, then this is not acceptable. So the Prophet called them a number of things. And the companions called them a number of things. And the ulama after them called them a few things. They said that the Firqat al-Najiyah are also called the Ta'ifa al-Mansura, another Arabic phrase that should not be far from our minds. At-Ta'ifa al-Mansura, which means the group that is the victorious group. At-Ta'ifa al-Mansura. They have the Nasr. And that's again because of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alayhi wa sallam. La tazalu ta'ifatun min ummati ala al-haqqi mansura. Another narration, yuqatiluna ala al-haqq. Many, many narrations come. There will not cease to be a group from my ummah who will be victorious. And he described them with many descriptions. لا يضرهم من خالفهم ولا من خذلهم حتى يأتي أمر الله وهم على ذلك. It will not hurt these group of people. It won't hurt them. Those people were in opposition to them. Or those people who tried to trick them. Their attempts to be in opposition to them, whether they're Muslims or kuffar, the enemies to the sect that the Prophet brought, the religion that his companions were upon, people in opposition to it. Muslims are in opposition to it. Our relatives are in opposition to it. Muslim relatives are in opposition to it. It doesn't hurt them, that opposition. Nor does it hurt them, those people who tried to trick them, like politically. Al-Khudlan is something that happens usually due to politics, where you trick a person. You say to him, okay, come on, we're going to go and we're going to do this particular thing. We both have to jump down. We have to jump distance. And once we jump down, you can't go back up. So he says to me, go ahead, you go first. So I jump down. I look up, I say, come on. He said, I'm not jumping down here. That's Khudlan, that they leave you in the dark like that at a time when you need them. Prophet Muhammad said, this type of behavior from their enemies won't hurt them. Why? Because it's the religion of Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is what happened with the companions with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The munafiqun used to do khudlan. The kuffar of Quraysh used to do this to the companions. Used to do this to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The army would go out and a third of the army would turn around. They used to do all kinds of stuff. And yet, the religion prevailed. So as long as the group of people who are trying to be on this thing, they go through the footsteps the way the companions did, Ridwanullahi alayhim, it's not your job and it's not your responsibility to get victory. It's not your job, it's not your responsibility to reach the finish line. Our job and our responsibility is only stay on the path and don't go to the right or the left of the path. If you arrive at the end, alhamdulillah. And if you die in the process, but you're on the path, when the people come to pick you up, to go and wash your body and to shroud you, they found you on the path. We're going to say Alhamdulillah. We say Alhamdulillah. Because the other paths, they may arrive. But the arrival that they made is not the real one. It's something that is muzawwar. It's not real. It's like fake money. It's counterfeit. It's not even real. So as a result of that hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called them the At-Ta'ifa Al-Mansura. They're the same as the Firqat Al-Najiyah. And the scholars also called them the Ghuraba. And this is the unique thing about this particular group and this particular path. Who are the people from the saved sect? All of these jama'at that the Muslims created for themselves, all of them are named after either an individual who started it or has something to do with it, or named after some slogan or some idea that those people were known for. Whereas the people who are on this path, they don't have any name that they made up for themselves. The name came from the hadith. The name came from the ayat of the Quran. The name came from what the first three generations taught the community during their time. Everybody else, the group is going to be named after this and that and that. And this is why we vehemently oppose being called Wahhabis. You never find a person on the Sunnah being happy and accepting. Although we like the individual, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, but when people try to insist on putting that name, you'll find people of the Sunnah saying, don't call me that. I don't even accept you calling me a Muhammadin. I'm not a Muhammadin. And he's the Sayyid of Bani Adam. But don't call me that. Because Allah didn't call me that. And there's nothing in the religion that will give credit to me being called a Muhammadin. Don't call me that. Don't call me that. No one accepts that, people of the Sunnah. And that's because when you look at these ayat and these ahadith, we don't want to connect ourselves to people like that. We want to connect ourselves to ideas that have been given to us. And we do our best to get as close to getting the bullseye in terms of being upon and practicing that particular idea. So they came up with the word the ghuraba. Because of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ and all of the hadith that I mentioned to you, when we say who are the saved sect, these are giving us characteristics of the saved sect. In the hadith, you get the character, who is that from the saved sect? The one who was doing what these hadith are saying. That's who they are. It's not the one who stands up and he screams on the microphone and he says, I'm from the Firqat al-Najiyah. I'm from the Ta'if al-Mansura. He may not be showing the reality of his claim and the way he believes and the way that he practices the religion. So the emphasis is not again upon the words. They're upon the emphasis, the context of the hadith. The saved sect, the Ta'if and Mansura, are those individuals who are just on this religion the way the companions. It's the first description. They are those individuals who, like this hadith mentioned, he said, Al-Islam began as a stranger, began strange. In al-Islam, bada'a ghariba, wa say'ud ghariba. Fatuba lil-ghuraba. Al-Islam began as something strange and is going to return as something strange. And this hadith is definitely a dalil of the nabuwa of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's no way in the world he could have prophesied and told us all of these details that we see coming to us every single day. As if he's right here living with us. And he's not living with us. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But Allah revealed to him. And he told us all of these things. And then he described those strangers. He said that they're going to get a place in Jannah. Tuba, a special tree, a special place has been preserved for them in Al-Jannah. This hadith has many, many narrations that give us added superlatives and descriptions, sifat of those ghuraba. In one hadith, he mentions sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wasallam about those people, alladhina yaslahun idha fasada an-nas, Who are the ghuraba, ya Rasulullah? He said, they're the people who make islah and they correct what the people made awry. They're the ones who the community, the people, they made something, they created something, and they did something. They're doing things that is incorrect the way it's being done, the way it's being said, the way it's being understood. The ghuraba are the regular people. Doesn't have to be a scholar. Doesn't have to be an Arab. Doesn't have to be someone who memorized the Quran. He can just be a regular. I'm a Bakr Zaid from the people who goes and he says, hey, ummi, Rasulullah is not hazir nazir. And he uses his time to give dawah to the people around him about that. He doesn't want any of his people to check out with that kind of aqidah, because as they're traveling the path, hazir nazir, hazir nazir, hazir nazir, and he falls dead on the path. When we go and we pick him up and we wash him and we shroud them and we put him in the ground, that person is in trouble. Hazir nazir. Allah is going to ask him, who created you? And he's going to say, hazir nazir. Rasulullah was an ilah with you, ya Allah. I worship the Nabi. Allah's going to ask him, who gave you life? He's going to say, hazir nazir. Rasulullah used to worship. Rasulullah used to worship. And he's on the path. But what path he's on? On a messed up path. So that regular brother, that regular sister, doesn't have to get the khutbah. He's saying, hey, ummi, hazir nazir is not correct. That person is from the ghuraba. The things that were created. And the people think this is the religion. They don't have to be the bravest people in the world. Don't think we're talking about that. Everybody in the audience, you have a responsibility to make jihad. To be of those people who are going to try to be from the safe sect. What safe sect? The ghuraba. Who are the ghuraba, ya Rasulullah, the strangers? They are those people who rectify what the people messed up. Whatever it is in the religion, they messed it up. And another narration similar to that, some of the scholars said that the word al-islah here is al-ladhina yaslahun. And another way, the dhabt of the kalima, al-ladhina yuslihun. So it's two meanings. The ghuraba are those people who they rectify themselves. They rectify themselves during the time of fitna. They rectify themselves. They don't get involved in the fitnas that are going on. They don't help to perpetuate it. There's drama, there's fitna. They're not a part of that that equation. They stay out of it. Those are the ghuraba. And the other way of understanding it is the ones who rectify, both of them. Another narration, very important. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he described them, unas salihun fi unas su'in kathir. Man ya'asihim aktharu man yati'uhum. Who are the ghuraba, ya Rasulullah? He said, they're a group of people who are righteous people. They're salihun. Around them are many, many people who are no good. Many, many people are no good. Those people who listen to them are fewer. Those people who listen to them are fewer than the people who obey them, who follow what they're saying. Those people who listen to them, they're the minority. The majority of the people are not going to listen, as I told you, because the majority of the people, they're going to, at that time, at this time, their mafhum, the understanding of Islam, is different from what the Prophet brought, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why, again, ikhwani, I plead with you, and I remind myself, I implore you, we need to relax as it relates to our community. Our community are regular people. We don't have a lot of knowledge. People who are teaching us, we don't have a lot of knowledge. So when giving da'wah to the community, be clear, especially when it comes to the non-Muslims. I do believe we have to be wise, but we have to be strong in being very clear with the non-Muslims about, we're not apologizing about our religion. But when it comes to our community, I think we have to take it easy. And that's what we found with the ulama of this era, that were the ones who we perceive as being the imams of the safe sect. And Allah knows best. Al-Albani ibn Baz, ibn Uthaymeen. The way they taught this community, the way they gave instructions, the way they gave dawah to the people. It was a way in which you see These people have understanding, and as a result of understanding of the Kitab and the Sunnah, the way of the companions, they also have understanding how to deal with the people. I heard a tape of an Imam Al-Albani. Some young brother came to debate him. The brother didn't have any knowledge. I've heard Al-Albani debate people from Hizb ut-Tahrir and other people, and he's rough and tough with them. I heard him debate a Salafi sheikh about different things, and he was rough with him, putting his personality down along with the knowledge. Because he's older, he would interrupt the person and say, no, no, you listen, and he would put his point across. But when he was debating with this regular brother from the Ammat al-Nas, that young brother was cutting Al-Albani off. That young brother was being tough with Al-Albani. And you can hear him laughing and being joking and taking it easy. When the boy left, they asked him, why were you like that with him? He said, because he's from those people who don't know. And when you give dawah ila Allah, dawah to Allah, if you want to give a little bit of knowledge, you need a ton of hikmah. You want to give a little bit of knowledge, you need a ton of hikmah, because the ghuraba, they are a few people. Those people who listen to them, they're the minority. They are the minority to those people who don't listen to them and don't disobey, and they don't obey what they have to say. So again, all of those descriptions give you an idea of the safe set. They're the people who rectify themselves. Now, if one of us is giving dawah to Allah, and I say, as I said many times before, and I'm not the first one to say this, so it's no special issue. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, when he mentioned this thing about, and this is important, ikhwani, don't hide this information, it's the reality. When he mentioned about a Salafiyya, and he said that the group that calls itself Salafi, a group of people, they call themselves Salafi. The Sheikh made it very, very, very clear. Salafis as a group like that, they could be like everybody else. They could be like all of those other groups that are rejected. If they're doing the things that would disqualify them from being on the path of those companions. So if the Salafi person, the professed Salafi person, the group of us, all of us in this room, all of us, if we are a group of people, we're a group of people, and we're loving and we're hating people based upon just a name. But when we look at our behavior, we're not the examples of what the companions were doing. Then we're like all of those other groups. We're like everybody else. We're like everybody else. You have created a group. You just added that name Salafi to it. But you, in your behavior, you're not what the companions were upon. Your ibadah is not like the companions. Even what you think, your aqidah, it's not what the companions. Because when we come, we ask you about aqidah, you're mixed up. You don't know what you're talking about. You don't know what you're talking about. So we don't excuse any of these groups. But at the same time, in terms of the theory, as I said to you, the Muslim has to make it his business, has to make jihad, do the best that he possibly can to try to be again on the religion of the companions. And that's why in this masjid they are given these weekly talks about the 10 people promised Jannah. Because they're the best people of this ummah, so get to know them. They are the religion. But it doesn't stop there. I mean, forever we should be giving talks about the companions. Khutbahs about the companions. People have to come to know about the companions. It is not enough. I remember from day one of becoming a Muslim, I have always seen, and the shelves of the bookstores of the Muslims in English, books about the personalities in Al-Islam. And that's because you can't be a real Muslim without knowing about those personalities. What did they do? What did they not do? What did they go through? What were they upon? So the people who wrote those books, their niyat may not necessarily have been about showing the importance of following the companions, but at least this ummah knows, they know, that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are an integral part of each and every individual practicing Islam correctly. So the people who are the safe sect, they're then the ones who make islah within themselves, and they also rectify outside of themselves. They're those individuals who, when people are against them and there's ikhtilaf and the people against them, no matter how many, they don't start to become people who are afraid and faint-hearted just because everybody's not with them. Because this is the way it is. The saved sect of those people who are following the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, the ghuraba. Lastly, or the issue before last, is that the scholars also call them Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Again, because of the hadith. And it is a synonym. Ahl al-Sunnah, not one thing. Al-Ghuraba, not another thing. The Firqat al-Najiyah, not a third thing. And the Ta'if al-Mansurah is not a fourth thing. They're synonyms. Different words that have the same meaning. They're the same thing. It's just an added piece of information that comes to us from the hadith. Everybody else, Jahmiyyah, Al-Jabariyyah, all of them, Shaziliyyah, all of them, they're going to have some name connected to some human being or some idea, some slogan. The people of the Sunnah, not like that. They're connected to things that came from the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, that came from the words in the mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the ulama of Islam, way back then, all the way up until now, they were the ones who were informing the people and teaching the people and educating the people about these particular issues. And again, the emphasis is not upon the name, Ahl al-Sunnah. Because of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, you have to take my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa. And all of those ahadith that talked about the time of trials and tribulations in which he told the people, take my sunnah. Argue with them with my sunnah. When you see these people dealing with them with the mutashabihat, the ambiguous issues, argue with them with my sunnah. All of those ahadith, may the scholars come up with this, Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. We already told you earlier, he said, when they asked him, who are they, Ya Rasulullah? He said, the people doing what I'm doing today and the Jama'ah. They are the Jama'ah. They are the Jama'ah. So they're Ahl al-Sunnah wal jama'ah, because they stick to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they stick to the jama'ah. But now, today, we have some people who have practically hijacked that particular description, and this is why I say it's not important. The emphasis is not on the names. Right here in Birmingham, other than Birmingham, we have the people of the Asha'ira who scream very loud that they are Ahl al-Sunnah. And I say, okay, no problem. You can scream that as loud as you want. You can scream that as long as you want. Just as I can scream as loud as I want, I'm Salafi. But if you come and you look at what I'm doing and what I'm thinking and how I am, with Allah Azza wa Jalla, it's a different issue. With Allah, it's a different issue. With the reality, it's a different issue. So now we're presented with this issue today. Today. Some people are saying, Ahl al-Sunnah, and they're not Ahl al-Sunnah. They're from the Maturidiyah. They're from the Asha'ira. So should we give them that? Should we allow that? I say yes, I don't think it's a big problem. Because those scholars of Islam, as I told you many times, they say you shouldn't fight and argue over these types of technical words. Technical words, you shouldn't fight over them. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Rasulullah. But when the kuffar of Quraysh told him, we're not going to fight you, we wouldn't be fighting you if we believe you were Rasulullah, he said, okay, take that away. He didn't waste his time telling them, I know I'm Rasulullah, I am Rasulullah, we must write that down. He said, okay, Ali, take it off, erase it, no problem. And he knows that he's Rasulullah. So the emphasis is in what is manifested. He's Rasulullah. But when they said, we're not going to go a step further in this contract until you take that off, he took it off. The Basmala, Bismillah. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. They say we know Bismillah. We don't know Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Take that off. Allah's Ar-Rahman. Allah's Ar-Rahim. The Prophet didn't argue with them. He said, okay, no problem. No problem. Take it off. I know that Allah's Ar-Rahman. And I know that Allah's Ar-Rahim. So those people want to be like that? The word Salafi is the same way. Same way. We're living in a time right now, the media has hijacked the Salafiyah. A Salafiyah Jihadiyah. So they think Salafi and Salafiyya is ISIS, Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab, the media. They do that intentionally. They do that intentionally because they've studied about Ibn Taymiyyah and people like that. They've studied this dawah very well. And they know that the dawah of Salafiyah, the dawah of Ahlul Sunnah, they know that this dawah is the one dawah that is moderate in terms of solving these problems, but not unapologetic. Because if the time and the place and the circumstances were okay, then we're going to deal with them in the way that they deserve to be dealt with. But right now, it's not that way. So this dawah tells us, deal with the people in a particular way right now. They know that this is the dawah that accommodates the condition of the people. Anyway, do we stick to that word, Salafiyah, during this particular time? I say, don't make a big deal out of it. Don't make a big deal out of it. Make the big deal out of it as it relates to your behavior, Ya Abdullah, as it relates to what you teach. You don't have to say that word once. Going to a masjid, you say that word, people are going to throw you out. They're not going to listen to you. They're going to get up. They don't want to listen to you anymore. Okay, then don't say that word, but give dawah to the people. And I tell you, being a da'i in this country, I'm going to tell you something, and I'm going to tell you for free. You travel up and down this country and go to the different masajid of the Muslims, like you people. But I wouldn't say like you, because you guys have been exposed more than other masjids. And we need to do a lot more. You go to these different masjids and you will find that the vast majority of our ummah, if given an opportunity on a day of Jummah, where they have to sit and listen to the khatib, if you put our dawah across with hikmah and clarity, the fitrah of the person is impressed with it. His fitrah. If his mind has been contaminated because he's been exposed to all of these groups, like we have been. I came into this religion, I knew Jamaat Tabligh. I came into this religion, I knew this racist African-American group. They used to be the Nation of Islam, and then they became real Muslims, but they were ignorant, and they still had racism. So now if someone came to me to give dawah to me, I still have that garbage of what I was exposed to that I can't filter what this person is saying to me. So it's his job and it's his responsibility to know me, to know my background, to know who I am, to speak to my intellect, speak to my spirit, speak to my fitrah. As for coming and pouring water in my face, he's going to have a problem. As for coming and speaking down on me and calling me an innovator and I'm stupid and my mother and my father are stupid, he's going to have a problem. But if you present the dawah to the people, generally speaking, I'm not saying in the Jummah they're going to stand up and say, hey, we want to all be Salafi today. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying the fitrah of the people is that the people don't want khurafat. They don't want that stuff. But if he was left to his own vices, he's not going to learn. It's going to be business as usual. The religion as usual. So it becomes the responsibility of the people doing the sunnah to take your dawah out and not to have a dawah that is exclusive. This dawah is my dawah. It's only for us. It's only for the people here who are with me on the same page. And everybody else is a hizbi. We're not talking to anybody else. Mubtadi, we don't talk to you. We don't mix with you any. And on the day of the Eid, don't bring any hizbis to the Eid. What are you talking about? We have to take our dawah out to the Muslims. Take our dawah out to the non-Muslims. Take our dawah out to the outer public without any apologies. But we have to do it in a way with hikmah, with knowledge, knowing what we're doing. So again, go back to that point. I'm of the opinion we shouldn't make a big deal out about using these words as Salafiyah. I use that word because I think it's appropriate. But I go to places and I don't use that word. Last thing that we want to mention, Ikhwani, is from the synonyms of this particular issue. And I hope you people get the point that this is not a theoretical lecture that you sit there and you say, what's the guy talking about? What I'm talking about to all of you is, everybody here, your religion has to be the religion that the companions were upon. That's what this is about. My religion and your religion. And again, I'm going to stop this and not go up to half past the hour, because I'm hoping someone in the audience is going to say, yeah, but I want to be Hizbut Tahrir. And this ayah allows me to, so we can discuss. Not so I can fight you. But if you really believe that, I want to be Jamaat al-Tabligh. I want to be Jamaat al-Islami. I'm going to give you an opportunity. I'm going to give you an opportunity. This lecture, Ikhwani, is about the Hadith. Who's a safe sect, Ya Rasulullah? Who are they? They're the ones who are doing what I'm doing today and my companions. Now we come to the last synonym, and that is Ahlul Hadith. Ahlul Hadith. Those scholars of the past, who we all love, honor, and we respect. And they are many, many, many. Some of them have been described as being Amir al-Mu'mineen in Hadith. They're the highest level in Hadith. When they talked about these Hadith, when Al-Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Amir al-Mu'mineen in Hadith, when he would tell this Hadith or he was questioned, who are the Firqat al-Najiyah? Who are they? Who are they doing our time? He would say they're Ahlul Hadith. They're the people of Al-Hadith. And the people of Hadith doesn't mean Al-Hadith, doesn't mean Al-Hadith of Pakistan and India and Afghanistan and Bangladesh. Didn't mean that. If you say to a person who is from that area, those countries, it may be bro, we deal bandi, you say to him, are you Ahlul Sunnah? He say, yeah, I'm Ahlul Sunnah. Are you Ahlul Hadith? He'll say, A'udhu Billah, A'udhu Billah, A'udhu Billah. Because his understanding of Ahlul Hadith is those other guys, Wahhabis, don't love the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I'm not talking about a group of Muslims from Pakistan called Ahlul Hadith who came over here and built this masjid as their markaz. And then they branched out all through the UK and in Europe. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the white revert who, when the Hadith comes to him, that's his religion. I'm talking about the South African who, when the Hadith comes to him, that's his religion. I'm talking about the Somali person who, when the Hadith comes to him, that's his religion. It's against the Shafi'i madhab. It's against his sheikh. It's against his qabil. It's against his government. The Hadith said this. He said, I'm taking the Hadith. I'm my head and I'm my eye. Ar-Ras wal-Ain. That's Ahlul Hadith. Al-Imam Ahmed, Al-Imam Ahmed, Amir al-Mu'mineen, fil Hadith. They said, who is the Ta'ifa al-Mansura? Who is the Firqat al-Najiyah? He said in his famous words, in lam takun Ahlul Hadith, wa lastu adri manhum. If it's not Ahlul Hadith, I don't know who they are. Which Ahlul Hadith? The people were Ahlul Hadith during his time. Those people were defending the Aqidah of al-Islam, spreading the religion. Defending the religion of al-Islam against non-Muslims. They were doing all kinds of things. And Ahlul Hadith, they don't make any distinction between the knowledge of Hadith and the knowledge of Fiqh. Meaning, both of those sciences are vehicles by which we worship Allah. Not, we're going to just pay attention to the Hadith and not the Quran. We're going to pay attention to the Hadith and not the Fiqh. No, the ulama of al-Hadith, they're the fuqaha. They are the fuqaha. Sometimes the fuqaha are not always the people of al-hadith. But you'll find the people of al-hadith, the ulama of al-hadith, they're the ones who are making the istinbat of the Quran and the sunnah. So Ahlul Hadith, all of those, Al-Imam Ali al-Madini, who is the Firqat al-Najiyah? He said Ahlul Hadith. So all of those scholars, one of the greatest scholars in al-Islam, Ikhwani, during the latter times, Al-Imam Al-Khatib Al-Baghdadi. He died 463. Al-Imam Al-Khatib Al-Baghdadi wrote in everything, especially Hadith. He has a book called Sharaf Ashab Al-Hadith. The honor of the people of Al-Hadith. The honor of the people of Al-Hadith. And he brings the names of many of these scholars who explain the thing that I'm explaining to you right now. That the people of Al-Hadith, they are the Firqat al-Najiyah. But Al-Imam Al-Khatib Al-Baghdadi, in the book, when he brought those statements of the Imam, he put a lot of emphasis on letting people understand, let people know, Ahlul Hadith, Ikhwani, if this masjid, Green Lane Masjid, the markaz of Ahlul Hadith, if we became a group of people who were doing everything and anything that is cool in order to get people to come to this masjid and to donate, we're compromising the principles of this religion. We're falling into innovation. We are doing things that are against the religion, and that becomes the minhaj of the people in this place. You're not Ahlul Hadith, even if Ahlul Hadith is written on your building. And even if we come up with hoodies and thobes, Ahlul Hadith, and we're Ahlul Hadith. Ahlul Hadith should be every single Muslim from Nigeria, from Gambia, every single Muslim from wherever you come from. And you should have this i'tizaz. You know, I don't really know how you brothers are sitting there and you're thinking. Because, you know, we got a lot of drama going on in our community. But I don't know. I think if I was sitting there as a new Muslim, and I heard someone telling me, hey, we have to be on the religion of the companions and things like that. I don't know if I would be a person who would be in opposition to that if the individual told me in a nice way. If he told me in a nice way. I'm trying to tell you guys in a nice way. All of these groups in Al-Islam are a problem. They are part of the problem that this ummah is dealing with today. Part of the problem. If this ummah just went back to understanding, comprehending, practicing this religion the way the people of Hadith did in the past, not Pakistan, India, Ahlul Hadith. People who took the Hadith in the words of the Prophet ﷺ, then you will clearly see that a lot of this stuff would be able to be managed and would be able to deal with. So everybody, make an attempt. Make it your business to be from Ahlul Hadith. Keep it in mind, I'm not here encouraging anybody to walk around screaming these words. But although I believe, saying Salafi and all that stuff, I wouldn't do that. But Ahlul Hadith, I'll continue to hang on to that. Me personally, as a speaker. And that's because, to me, it has a broader meaning. And historically, I believe the people here, this masjid, they owe it to the people from a long time ago, from the ulama of this dawah, who used to go out and used to make crazy mad jihad in Pakistan, Bangladesh, and all those places where shirk was prevalent. And those people, you know, over there, overseas, it's not like here. You can speak what you want to speak, and for the most part, you're going to be okay. Over there, there's sectarianism. People will kill you if you said the truth that you believe. This talk right here will get me killed in Nigeria today. I can't go to Mike Duggery and say Boko Haram. I can't say that. I'm telling you. I can't go to Mogadishu talking about Shabab. This kalam will get you killed. Over here, it's not like that. Alhamdulillah, it's not like that. This is not the case. But back then, those people and those ulama used to give da'wah to Allah, and their lives were on the line. Their enemies and who were in opposition will put bombs on the table and under the table and blow them up. He's about to deliver a lecture, and he gets blown up. To that degree, you mean to tell me we can't come and have a debate and a discussion? You're going to blow him up and kill other innocent people just to get to your point? But that man is looking at that one as a true live enemy. So now, people who are connected to that idea of Ahlul Hadith, they built this masjid. They purchased this masjid. And that masjid, I say, you owe it to the legacy of those people who are directly connected to you to hold on to the word and to pump this word and to make it a word that is unique, but the emphasis should be upon the essence of the word, the application of the word. Okay, Ikhwani, if you guys have any questions, inshallah, azza wa jal, you could put your question forward. The kanindukum sheikh, fadhi ya sheikh. Now, my brother said that Jamaat al-Islami are only called Jamaat al-Islami because they follow in politics, and I don't have a problem with them, with the name. That ain't really the big issue. The issue is when you look at the minhaj of Jamaat al-Islami, see, as you mentioned, politics is the problem. The political groups in the Muslim world today are a problem. The ghuraba. الَّذِينَ يُصْلِحُونَ عِنْدَ فَسَادِ النَّاسِ The ghuraba they make islah. You know this Arab Spring? This Arab Spring. The Ikhwan Muslimin are responsible for the Arab Spring. The political group Ikhwan al-Muslimin are responsible because of the way they understand changing the evil and so forth and so on. They supported it and they called to it. And it's not Islah. This Arab Spring has put the Muslims back many years. Caused money and lives to be lost. And Jamaat al-Islami is on that same minhaj. Al-Ikhwan al-Muslimin. Am I saying every person from Jamaat al-Islami is a bad person and a bad individual? No, they have some good people, righteous people, I'm sure. People who know the religion, I'm absolutely sure. But their minhaj, their personalities, are people of siyasa. Which siyasa? Which siyasa? The siyasa of Machiavelli. Machiavellian said, Democrats, Republicans, Labor, you know, that stuff that we have. The ends justify the means. Compromising in order to get the ends. And when the Salafi people did the same thing in Kuwait, in Egypt, same thing. The siyasa, politics, dirty, stinky politics. They come and they dirty the water of your dawah. Your dawah starts to become unclear. We had shuyukh in Egypt. People on the sunnah, calling to the sunnah. When the Arab Spring came and when things started to happen, some of those Salafi sheikhs, they got behind that stuff and they lost their position because politics are dirty and nasty. These types of politics. So all we have to do is look historically at the individuals of Jamaat al-Islami, Abu Ya'la al-Mawdudi, rahimahullahu ta'ala. All we have to do is look at the personalities of the Ikhwan al-Muslimin and we just judge what they did and what they said. Based upon the kitab and the sunnah. And you judge in a way where they call it the tajreed. You're open-minded. You're open-minded. He either said it or he didn't say it. He did it or he didn't do it. And what they said and what they did is not in accordance to what the companions were doing and saying, especially as it relates to siyasa. And if anybody want any details, give me an example of that. Give me an example of that. Where their dawah was exposed and their reality was exposed, all you have to do is say, give it to me, and we'll give you the opportunity to go and study it yourself. And Allah knows best. I don't want anybody, and I'm not apologizing, but I don't want anybody in the audience to think, oh, that guy hates everybody. I'm not like that. But I'm going to call a spade. I'm going to call it how I see it. I'm going to call it how I see it. So I'm not saying every person from Jamaat al-Islam is in the hellfire. I'm not saying that. Every person, Jamaat al-Tabligh, hellfire. I'm not saying that. I'm saying look at the ethos. Look at the minhaj. Look what they were saying. Look what they were believing. Look what they did. Look what they wrote. And then you'll see. This is not the what the companions were upon. And Allah knows best. Go ahead, my man. Fadda. Fikum barakallah.
This question relates to how you then address those aqidah issues. So, for example, you mentioned that the Ikhwan, their failures. Now, we come across some of the brothers who profess to be Salafi and they're very harsh in their words. In, for example, you have said that this was unwise, this led to death. But they go a step further, two steps further, and they say that these men are evil, they deserve their punishment at the hands of the kuffar. Is this something that would you
I think that's insanity, to be honest with you, and that is not part of, and that is, that is not part of a Salafia. I gave the khutbah today in my hometown here in the UK. My hometown is Keithley, up in the north. It's my hometown, because home is where the heart is. Whenever I travel to Keithley, I feel like I'm going home. When I come to Birmingham, I start getting muta nervous all the time. I get muta nervous here. I don't feel at home. In that community is a small masjid, Ahlul Hadith. Over there is a big masjid built from the ground up, and it is beautiful. When I lived there, it wasn't there, but I went in there to see it today. It was beautiful. And then the other masjid that these people broke off from over there, Brawi Brawi. And I told the people in the khutbah, hey, I'm not going to go and pray in those masjids. I am not going to go to pray in those masjids and to perform Jummah in those masjids. I'm not going to do that. But
the contemporary issues that are on the table that are facing us, the challenges that are facing our community, I'm going to cooperate with them in tackling those issues. And if anything were to happen to those brothers, a masjid got burnt down, someone broke into a masjid and lit it on fire, something happened, I won't rejoice at that. I heard some brothers who claim Salafia saying crazy things like that. Crazy things. The FIS in Algeria, the generals were oppressive. We don't want those guys to rule over us. We don't want the people of politics, Islamic politics, who don't know what they're doing to rule over us, neither. But well, that doesn't make us say that the generals are good. We're not going to do that. So I used to hear some of those brothers used to say, the Algerians are getting what they deserve because they're not doing the Islam and the Sunnah. What are you talking about, man? How do you talk like that? How do you rejoice in something like that? So I don't think that's correct. I think that's a sickness, brother. And I think that's that Hizbiyah that is in some Salafis in their mind, that they're too crazy with that. And that's why we find the people of the past, even Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he dealt with some of his companions in a tough way to address their issue, like Ka'b ibn Umarik, boycotting him for 50 days along with the other two companions of Ka'b. And yet, when it came to Munafiqun, he was being gentle with them, nice to them, you know, trying to win them over, dealing with them in a nice way. He didn't say to them, may Allah break their back, may Allah put, he didn't do, because he had some goal and objectives, things that he was trying to accomplish. So I don't agree with that. And you and me, we should never let people cause us to be deterred from the truth because he's the one who's doing this. And it is true, akhi. Salafi people many times are too rough and too tough in the wrong place and in the wrong way. And it's one of the things that causes people not to want our dawah. That's true. May Allah forgive us all for being a part of that and help us to be better dua. Help us to be better dua. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he was hakim. Rahim, he was easy. Halim, he was gentle. And he said about that akhlaq, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, when he was asked, what did get you into Jannah more than anything else? He said, taqwallah wa husnul khuluq. You want to go to the Jannah? Then have taqwa and husnul khuluq. What's husnul khuluq? Having sabr with the person. Having hilm with the person. Having rifq, taking a gentleness with the person. Being sensitive to the person. You want to go to Jannah? Have good akhlaq and not bad akhlaq. Ma min shay' athqalu fil mizani yawm al-qiyamah min al-husnul khuluq. Husnul khuluq. Nothing will be heavier in the mizan than good character. And I'm rough and tough with the people and I'm calling this Salafi Islam. La. The one who made that statement, that is a form of ISIS. He's not from ISIS. He's against ISIS. But that statement is the dawah of ISIS and Boko Haram and Shabab. That statement. They deserve it. You just don't have a gun because you don't have a heart. Fadri Akhi, I'm going to stop here after this, inshallah. Sheikh Abu Muhammad. Hey, what time is the adhan, Muadhin Saab? Now. Last question. As the brother is mentioning, as we give dawah to Allah, ikhwani, the dawah should be gentle and it should be easy. And that's how the Prophet was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we give dawah to people, especially our relatives, gentleness and ease would help to secure your dawah being accepted by people. As the Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that gentleness was never put inside of something except it beautified it. And toughness was never, and gentleness was never taken out of something except that it made it ugly. So Rasulullah was a gentle being, a gentle man as it came to the issue of a dawah to Allah. And the people of the Sunnah, Ahl al-Sunnah, they are the most merciful people upon the creation. And they're the most knowledgeable people as it relates to the Creator. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استووا تواصوا سووا صفوفكم سد الخلل في الجابس الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين هو الذي خلقكم من تراب ثم من نطفة ثم من علقة ثم يخرجكم طفلا ثم لتبلغوا أشدكم ثم لتكونوا شيوخا ومنكم من يتوفى من قبل ولتبلغوا أجلا مسمى ولعلكم تعقلون هو الذي يحيي ويميت فإذا قضى أمرا فإنما يقول له كن فيكون ألم تر إلى الذين يجادلون في آيات الله أنى يصرفون الذين كذبوا بالكتاب وبما أرسلنا به رسلنا فسوف يعلمون إذ الأغلال في أعناقهم إذ الأغلال في أعناقهم والسلاسل يسحبون في الحميم ثم في النار يسجرون ثم قيل لهم أينما كنتم تشركون من دون الله قالوا ضلوا عنا بل لم نكن ندعو من قبل شيئا كذلك يضل الله الكافرين ذلكم بما كنتم تفرحون في الأرض بغير الحق وبما كنتم تمرحون ادخلوا أبواب جهنم خالدين فيها فبئس مثوى المتكبرين فاصبر إن وعد الله حق فإما نرينك بعض الذي نعدهم أو نتوفينك فإلينا يرجعون الله سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين ولقد أرسلنا رسلا من قبلك منهم من قصصنا عليك ومنهم من لم نقصص عليك وما كان لرسول أن يأتي بآية إلا بإذن الله فإذا جاء أمر الله قضي بالحق وخسر هنالك المبطلون الله الذي جعل لكم الأنعام لتركبوا منها ومنها تأكلون ولكم فيها منافع ولتبلغوا عليها حاجة في صدوركم وعليها وعلى الفلك تحملون ويريكم آياته فأي آيات الله تنكرون أفلم يسيروا في الأرض فينظروا كيف كان عاقبة الذين من قبلهم كانوا أكثر منهم وأشد قوة وآثارا في الأرض فما أغنى عنهم فما أغنى عنهم ما كانوا يكسبون فلما جاءتهم رسلهم بالبينات فرحوا بما عندهم من العلم وحاق بهم ما كانوا به يستهزئون فلما رأوا بأسنا قالوا آمنا بالله وحده وكفرنا بما كنا به مشركين فلم يك ينفعهم إيمانهم لما رأوا بأسنا سنة الله التي قد خلت في عباده وخسر هنالك الكافرون الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله الله أكبر الله أكبر الله سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله الله أكبر الله سمع الله لمن حمده الله الله أكبر الله الله أكبر عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله